In this screencast, I thought we would go through an example that examines the use of the ideal gas law, and in particular, kind of gives us an idea of specific lab safety. So the question asks that if a researcher is working a lab with the dimensions of 15 feet by 15 feet by 10 feet, and an acetone drum might have been knocked over, and 10 liters of acetone spill on the floor, we're asked to determine what potential hazards might be created by this spill. Specifically, we're told that the researcher leaves the lab unaware of the spill and effectively seals the lab up on a day where the temperature is 30 degrees Celsius. Specifically, we're going to look at three potential hazards. As we know, acetone is a volatile, inflammable substance. If we assume that all the acetone evaporates into the lab space, does this create an explosive environment? Secondly, if 5,000 parts per million of acetone is inhaled, it could be severely hazardous to the nervous system. Would someone who enters this environment and breathe be at risk? Thirdly, could the production of the acetone vapor act as an asphyxiant? And specifically, we're going to determine whether or not the amount of oxygen is lower than 15 volume percent. So let's go ahead and look at this first hazard, whether or not the acetone evaporated into the lab space would create an explosion hazard. To do this, we are going to examine both the lower flammable limits and the upper flammable limits for acetone. To look these up, what I would suggest doing is looking up an acetone material safety and data sheet, also known as an MSDS. When you pull one of these up, it's going to give you pertinent information about the properties of acetone as well as environmental and health hazards related to it. As we scroll down, we come across a section on fire and explosive data. We could see that the flammable limits in air, percent by volume, are 2.5% and 12.8%, meaning that if the acetone concentration by volume in the environment is between those two values, it does pose to be an explosive hazard. If it's lower than that lower limit, then we say that basically it's too lean to ignite, or if it's above the upper limit, we say it's too rich to ignite. So given this information and the information in the problem statement about the temperature and the volume of the space that this acetone is going to occupy, in reality what we want to determine is the percent of volume of acetone in this lab space. So we know that we could probably use the ideal gas law, written as PV equals nRT, especially at these conditions, we could assume that it behaves like an ideal gas, and calculate what that molar composition in this lab is going to be. So the first thing we have to do is assume that the only thing else in the lab is air, and that air is, in this case, and in most cases, 21% by volume oxygen and 79% by volume nitrogen. Assuming before the acetone evaporated that the pressure in the lab was 1 atmosphere, we know the temperature, we could look up a gas constant R, and we could calculate the volume of our space. So let's go ahead and calculate the volume of the lab space. When we multiply the 15 by 15 by 10, you should get about 2,250 feet cubed. And using a conversion factor for feet cubed to liters, it's about 63,710. At this point, we could go ahead and use the ideal gas law and calculate what the amount of moles of air would have been before the acetone evaporated. So when we plug in all of our values for the conditions listed, we should get the amount of moles of air to be about 2.56 kilomoles. We could repeat this calculation for the acetone, but for acetone, we actually know the amount of moles of acetone going into the lab, so what would make more sense is what happens to the acetone when it's evaporated. When all of the acetone goes from liquid to the vapor phase, it's going to create some kind of pressure in that lab. It's going to take up a certain amount of volume. We know what that volume is going to be. So we could repeat the same calculation using an unknown pressure of the acetone, in this case the partial pressure of acetone, times the volume of the lab. And this is going to be the moles of acetone that evaporates, again times the gas constant R, and the temperature that we already know. To determine the moles of acetone that's evaporated, we're given the information that 10 liters of acetone evaporates. So what's important is to determine how many moles 10 liters of acetone takes up. So we're going to need the density of acetone, and we're going to need the molecular weight of acetone. We could go back to the MSDS or we could look it up elsewhere. But the density of acetone is about 0.793 kilograms per liter, while the molecular weight of acetone is 58 kilograms per kilomole. And we could use this information, 10 liters times 0.7925 kilograms per liter is going to give us 7.925 kilograms of acetone. If we divide this by the 58.08 kilograms per kilomole, we end up getting the amount of moles of acetone to be equal to about 0.136 kilomoles. We can then use this back in our equation that we already mentioned with the given information. As you can see, the units right now I'm using are kilomoles for the amount of moles, and then our gas constant has moles. So if we make this 136 moles, we should have no problem with our units balancing out. What we find is that the partial pressure of acetone is 0.53 atmospheres. So at this point, there's two assumptions we could either go with. The first is that the presence of the acetone vapor pushes out some of the air vapor and maintains a pressure of 1 atmosphere in the lab. Or the second is that the new pressure in the lab, assuming that the lab is completely sealed, is the old pressure of the air plus the new pressure of the acetone. Either way, the calculations are going to be basically the same. I'm going to go ahead and use our second assumption, where we do effectively seal the lab and create a little higher pressure. What this is going to do at this point is let us figure out what the molar fraction of acetone in this space is. To do that, we could use our relationship where the mole fraction of acetone times the total pressure gives us the partial pressure of acetone. In this case, we know the pressure and the partial pressure, and therefore can figure out what the mole fraction of acetone is by dividing the two. This results in a mole fraction of 0.05. If we write that as a mole or percentage, or in this case a volume percentage, since they're ideal gases, they end up being the same, we're going to say that the volume percent is 5.0% for acetone. Now the question originally was, does this fall between our limits of 2.5% and 12.8% by volume? And we see that it does. So this hazard ends up being a very explosive hazard. So obviously this would be a problem that needs to be mediated. Our second part of the question asked whether or not the concentration of acetone is near the 5,000 parts per million that is severely dangerous to inhalation. So we need to relate the concentration of acetone to a parts per million basis. So let's go ahead and do that. So when we talk about parts per million, especially with gases, we're pretty much talking about a molar relationship. And what I mean by that is that if we had a million parts of a gas, then one part per million would be 1 mole, say in this case acetone, per that million parts of total gas. So 5,000 parts per million can be rewritten as 5,000 times 10 to the minus 6 moles of acetone per moles of gas. Now you could see this, and this already looks like something we've already written out, our molar fraction. And we knew that our molar fraction calculated was 0.05 moles of acetone per mole total. So hopefully you can see already that this is much higher than our 5,000 parts per million, but we could ask ourselves by how much to do that. And we divide it by our 5,000 parts per million, which would be rewritten as 0.005, and we can see that this is already 10 times higher than our safe limit for inhalation. So we have another hazard at play here. The last problem asks us to determine the O2 content and whether or not it was less than the 15% by volume. We could easily go back to our partial pressures relationship. We knew that the pressure of air prior to the acetone evaporating was 1 atmosphere, and we know that 21% by volume of that is oxygen. So the partial pressure of oxygen is 0.21 atmospheres. If we want to find out the molar fraction of oxygen, it's just the partial pressure of oxygen over the total pressure. This should give us a result of 0.199, and we can see that since the molar fraction and volume fraction are the same for ideal gases, that this 19.9% is higher than the 15% that poses a hazard. So the production of acetone in this environment does not act as an asphyxiant, but we do see that it has severe potential hazard as both an explosive environment and something that is above the safe limits for inhalation.